Thank you for coming along to In Conversations. I'm here with an immensely talented career musician, which is true. You're a career, and there's musicians that get in and get out, but you are, I feel, a career musician. You're a front woman, a singer, a constant student of song, and we'll be discussing all that today. Please give a big Newtown hand clap for Katy, Elizabeth Steele.
Hey.
Well, we're going to talk about a lot of stuff today, but I want to start at the beginning. Do you remember the first song you wrote that you got right, where you went, oh, yeah, maybe I am a songwriter?
Not really, but I think Relapse was the most natural, because it was written when I met my first boyfriend, and I was just obsessed and just, like, so in love with him, and he just didn't even know I existed. Which was really hard. But then, you know, we ended up getting together and we're together for a long time. But I was just in this place that you are when you're 17, where you're just like, man, it's just so much love and just it's just so intense. And honestly, I was so young, like our very first show with Little Betty, I had to sit down like this to play the guitar because I was so shit at guitar. You know, and then a couple of weeks later, you know, you're on stage, you're standing up and you're playing and you're better. And then a month later, you're a lot better. And then, you know, 2 months later, we're playing huge festivals. And it just happened in the blink of an eye. I was working at an American diner place called Johnny Rockets, where you like, there's like milkshakes and it's all like Aretha Franklin, and then if someone puts like Aretha Franklin song on, you have to get up and do this dance. So I used to hide in the fridge when they did the dance, and then I got fired because I kept doing that. Like, they're like, you gotta do the dance. I'm like, I ain't doing the dance, man.
They're great, those jobs, though, because you realize what you don't want to do with
yeah,
your
exactly.
life. You go, this is why I need to be successful at music, because I never want to be that person.
Yeah, so I was working the job there and I got a call from, we'd sent out the demo, a demo with four songs on it, and within that day we had a call from the manager that we wanted to manage us. We had a call from like two or three different labels, and you know, within a couple of weeks we were like just on the way. And I was 17, man.
Well, yeah. Why don't you play Relapse? This is from the first EP.
Live on the outside, I'll help you through your pain if you help me through mine. Never have I met someone as insensitive as you. I want to escape what you've done to my life. Existence is purpose. Explain what my touch means.
Gorgeous, gorgeous. What's your emotional connection to that song now? All these years later.
Yeah, I still feel the same. It's one of the only ones, I think, that I've actually written where it's just, it's like a body thing.
Yeah, I just watched you go somewhere else as you sang it. And then I thought, wow, is she faking it? She can't be faking it.
No, but no, man, it's hard to fake it.
No, well, it was amazing to watch. And I wonder, because some people say that about songs, don't they? That as time moves on, you have different relationships.
Yeah, I mean, if you'd asked me to play Beautiful or something like that, I wouldn't have the same gusto. And because that song is just, it's almost subconscious. Like, it's kind of like you get on the guitar and then it just, I laugh about it and say it falls out, but that's what happens. It just, you got to really be like open to it as well, I think. Like, I think sometimes I put too much pressure on myself to like, you know, I've been living in New Zealand and like writing like every day. And sometimes you just got to like, you got to kind of know when the right time is and just go, this is my window, boom, like grab it.
Does it get harder as you get older? People talk about it because you know more about music and songs. Like when you wrote that, that was just pure emotion.
I reckon it does, yeah.
It falls out your guitar.
Yeah, I reckon it does get harder. Because even when we were recording Baby Blue, I actually didn't know that the chorus had a key change.
Right.
Actually, and we were recording with Joel and he's like, I like what you did there with that key change in the chorus. I was like, what do you mean? I didn't even know what he was talking about. And so it's just like a natural thing. You know, when you don't really know what you're doing, you really come up with some cool stuff. That's why I never wanted to study music. Too much knowledge sometimes can be a bad thing, I think. You've got that tendency to probably be a bit more calculated with what you do. Mm. And whereas that's like the epitome of what I'm not about is being calculated, because it's just so organic and real and natural. Mm. There's a lot of artists out there that are just like really clever, but it kind of goes over people's heads.
You won the PDA, which is the Professional Development Award, which is an APRA initiative, which still runs. This is back in the day. How did that affect you?
We were just like touring like mental around that time. We were in London and New York, and I think we'd just gone to Tokyo, or we were about to go to Tokyo like around that time or something. And so, yeah, I'm pretty sure it just went into touring, which is well needed money.
Well, that's exactly where it should go, because at that time, suddenly all these opportunities are coming your way, and money can be the biggest obstacle to all those
exactly.
career paths.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah. Let's talk about songwriting, and I'm sure it's changed, but is there a process for you?
Usually starts with just chords, piano. I haven't been playing that much guitar recently. I've been working a bit more like with like getting loops and stuff, like drum beats. And I had this like weird chord thing that, didn't know what the chords were, then worked them out. So then that basically wrote the whole song. And then I took that sample out and used the chords. So I've been doing some other...
That's a very Prince thing.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. He had this thing where he used to lay down his core idea and then add 150 other things to it and then rip out the original idea, and that's how he got those sort of broken, amazing... That sounds incredibly funky. Like, how did he do that? It's because the original thing that was propping it all up is gone and it just does its...
Yeah, that's what I did.
So you're Prince. You've become Prince.
Bow down, bitches. I'll find that I might write something on guitar, and a really good technique is to then play it on piano to see how that feels. The same chords, same song, obviously. And just play it on a different instrument and see how it feels. And like, for me, it's just all about following that natural, you know, you might have a really good verse and you're like, okay, where is it going to go? It's got to go to the chorus. Okay, it's got to lift up, or it's got to, you know, it's got to move somewhere. And it's just, you know, I just put a record out and then I did a big tour, and then I went to New Zealand and just been hanging out there and writing. I find that moving around is like the best thing for me to inspire me. In New Zealand, I've just been focusing a lot on production, like really trying to get good at like sonics and mixing. I've always done my own demos and stuff, but I've never done them to a proper you know, proper level.
Before it used to, you had to be in the studio and you had to have the person there. Now it's like you can be on your laptop in.
I mean, that's the
on the beach in New Zealand.
That's the amazing thing about music now is like everyone can be a producer. You know, there's loops out there, there's samples, there's Moogs, there's everything's a little plug-in away, and you know, you can create a song in a couple of minutes just sitting there on your laptop. You know, I don't necessarily think that that's like the best way to make music, but in terms of just vibing out and creating, you know, you're still creating something.
We've got a lot of songwriters here. Can you give us a songwriting tip? You've been sharing your process, but do you have one essential tip for songwriting?
I'd say just be you, and get to the chorus within 30 seconds. No. I mean, I'm a pretty standard writer. Like, I definitely stick to a format. I've been messing around with that a bit more since I've been in New Zealand, though. My tip would be just to do what's you. Just be yourself and let it fall out, and then go back and put it back together, you know, and see what you've got on the table. That's how I write. I'll sit there with my iPhone and I'll put the dictaphone on, and some of them I'll just sit there for like 10 minutes, 15 minutes.
Let's talk about one of your brothers for a second, because I'm interested in this. Luke, who is obviously Sleepy Jackson and in Empire of the Sun, he had that surreal situation where one song took him to the world. Like, he'd written amazing songs up to the point of Walking on a Dream coming out, but he was also living, I think this is true, he was living in the back of your parents' place in a caravan with a baby on the way when that song came out. So he went from that. How was it to watch that situation, A, as a sister, but also as a musician, to see that meteoric, like God picked you up and just went, come to the world?
Yeah, I guess it's just a sign of the industry and how things can change in a second. I mean, it did for me when I was 17, I guess, so this was obviously a different kettle of fish, but he's worked hard his whole life. And
so many good songs.
Yeah, so many songs, and it just shows you you only really need that one song. That's what I tell myself.
But that's a perfect example. Someone in your family had happened to.
But I mean, it was hard for me because I'd just moved to New York. I was going through a real, a real phase of not really knowing what I wanted to do next. I just left the band and was living over there in this big city and didn't really know anyone, and I was really kind of flailing, I guess, and so it was hard to kind of witness. I mean, it sounds horrible saying it was hard.
No, I've got an older brother, it fucked me off completely.
I wouldn't go to Christmas dinner. Well, that's the thing, though. It's just got bigger and bigger and bigger, so now it's, Christmas is going to be interesting.
And now you're staying at... But that's really an honest reaction. Because, and that's you as a sister and as a musician,
well,
I guess.
Well, he did the same thing with me. When Little Birdie, like, blew up, Sleepy Jackson was kind of flailing a bit. They'd released their second record, and we were just, like, really up there, and he was kind of down here. So, and he got really angry at me. So, fuck him.
All right, well, let's change tack a little bit. We hear a lot about inequality in all workplaces. Have you ever found it a struggle being a woman and a girl in the music industry?
Yeah, I've never had any problems with it. Sexism definitely exists, but like you said, it exists in all workplaces. I feel like we're actually in a really exciting time at the moment. Like, there's more female artists out there now than there ever was. That doesn't mean there's, you know, stuff that goes down, but my personal experience is that I haven't experienced much. I guess I wouldn't stand for it, I guess, as well. Punch him in the head.
What was the effect of New York on your songwriting?
Yeah, it kind of stumped me. It didn't really work for me. I had this dream of becoming Carole King or something and living in this apartment with a piano, and fortunately I was living in a shitty place in Brooklyn with no windows, and it wasn't really the dream. Basically, I went there to kind of find myself, like, because I'd left the band and I was like, I'm going to go do my own thing and see where it takes me. And I kind of just really kind of lost myself, I guess, for a while. Made heaps of music, but, you know, the first 6 months I didn't really write anything good. Being from Perth and being from Australia, where we have so much space and people are so nice, and you know, things aren't really that extreme over here. And I think it was just kind of a bit too much to handle by myself, I guess. Like, I didn't really have anyone to bounce off. But now I've kind of come through that. I think I'm like a hell of a lot stronger, and the stuff I'm making now is like really cool.
And it's interesting that you're now getting that space. You can look at the pop record and go, oh, actually, that wasn't so bad.
Yeah,
it's because
you were
probably being harder on yourself.
Oh, I got so ridiculously hard on myself that like nothing was good enough. And then I just had to like go, okay, you know what, I've just got to record something, hey. Because I'm never going to release anything at this rate. And I went into a studio in Perth and got in with a local guy, and we just hung out. And music's a mental thing, and meaning, you know, you use your emotions. And when I was in New York, I was having serious depression and serious anxiety. And you're never going to write anything good when you're not healthy in the mind and healthy in your body and just happy. I mean, you've got to be a little bit happy to want to do anything, you know?
Let's play something off that Rescue Boat we're going to play.
All right. Which is... That's going to have to do.
Everyone knows I try my best to make good. But when the devil calls, I send him right in. There's no sure reason or a relative mind. It's just the remnants of my usual time. I need a helping hand. I don't need no one night stand. 'Cause I'm doing all I can. I'm trying to make this work. I'm trying to see this through. I wanna be who only you believe in. I wanna be a who.
Now, you said there were a couple of songs that you wrote in New York that made it on the record. Was that one of those songs? Because it seems like a cry for help.
Yeah, it's pretty messed up over there. So.
Yeah, but from the realness of the emotion
came that song.
Out.
That's why I wanted to play that one, because that's probably the most autobiographical.
When you write a song, and because you played live for a long time now, how much do you think about live? My theory has always been write it for the studio, make it as good as possible, then work it out for live. But some people write for live. Do you ever do that?
When I was working on the record, we didn't really think about it at all. And then it got to doing the tour. And, you know, we had to put a bunch of stuff on a track because there was just, you know, I'd need like a 7-piece band in order to do all the percussion and all the different layers. It's kind of cool though, because you can kind of do anything these days. I do think you miss a lot of vibe when you don't have like, when you have a track, it's kind of cool when there's just three people vibing and you feed off each other.
We do write singles now, that's what...
Yeah. It definitely makes you think about when you release music, like, do you need to do a whole record? Like, I'm probably not going to do that. I'm probably going to do an EP next, and then another EP. And the good thing about that is you can just change it up each time. You don't need, like, 4 songs, 5 songs, and boom, and then the next thing. And you can really mess around. I probably should have done that 5 years ago, but it's like Disneyland or something now, you know. It's really all about like money, and I mean, maybe it's always been like that, but I feel like,
well, there's two vastly different industries. There's a bit that's like that, and then there's just millions and millions of people in their bedroom.
The monetization, yeah, of, you know, streaming, and you know, it's really hard to even survive. I feel like you got to kind of either accept it and get on with it, or just don't even bother. Like, that's my attitude. I'm just going to keep going for it.
Awesome. Look, thank you so much for your time. Give it up for Katy.